pie. To passionate chefs, cooking is an art. Knowing when exactly a cut of meat is done to perfection requires knowledge of your meat, your grill, and really most of the times comes down to a Jedi art, more so than a solid science. Now, I don't presume to take anything away from those passionate chefs who prefer to cook on nothing but a whim and a spatula. But, for those of us whose senses aren't quite yet that attuned, sometimes it helps to have a little help in the form of a meat thermometer that can tell us the temperature at the exact center of the meat. Now, this meat thermometer can be a lot more exciting if you build it yourself, and it can be even cooler if you use signal processing techniques to predict the temperature faster. The meat thermometer is an interesting project because it shows off how we can use engineering to vastly improve an otherwise crude design. The temperature sensor in this project really is just a thermometer that we are ramming into your steak. However, we do a series of things to make it a much better design. We first start with a physical assembly. It is true that physically sticking the whole temperature sensing chip inside the meat would be ideal for measuring the temperature, but it would probably not be that tasty. So we do the next best thing and transfer the heat using a small piece of copper wire. We attach this copper wire to the sensor using a small drop of superglue. Copper is very good at transferring heat, roughly 20 times better than stainless steel, and it is so much better than air that we can sort of assume that the temperature at the tip will quickly make its way over to the temperature sensor on the other side. To help transfer the heat from the copper wire to the chip itself, we use a piece of copper desoldering braid and wrap it around a couple of times. We also take the ground pin of the temperature sensor and bend it up against the desoldering braid. This creates a really quick thermal path from the braid to the internals of the chip. We then solder it all together. You want to be careful in this step because heating it for too long can damage the chip. Don't be too concerned about getting it all covered with solder. As long as the copper braid is wrapped around tightly, it should be good enough. The point of all this is to do our best to make sure it's a very short thermal path from the tip of the wire probe to the temperature sensor chip itself. Now, we solder some wire onto the lead so that we can plug it into our breadboard. We made a wire braid out of the normal colored wire. You can solder the ground wire onto any part of the solder braid, but make sure there is a solder path between your ground wire and the ground pin of the temperature sensor. We also wrap some electrical tape around the leads so we can keep them all electrically separated. Then, we covered the chip and the leads in 5-minute epoxy. This serves both to keep the whole setup together and protect the electronics from the food or water you might be sticking it near.
You know you're an engineer when you're more worried about your electronics than your food.
At this point, our contraption is ready to be used as a thermometer, and we connect it to the nerdkit and from there to the computer. But looking at this live graph of temperature versus time, you see that the whole system is really quite slow to react to a changing temperature. This relatively slow reaction from a change in temperature at the tip to a change in the output signal can be fine if you're measuring a relatively steady room temperature, but when you're looking for a more instantaneous reading from your meat, you have to be a little more creative. This is a good time to talk about a very advanced topic, the transfer function of a system. All linear systems with inputs and outputs can be thought about in terms of the transfer function of the system. We sort of got a peek at the transfer function of our thermometer when we looked at what happened when we stuck it in hot water. When we stuck it in hot water, we very quickly changed the temperature at the tip from room temperature to boiling. But you saw that the output actually took a little while to respond. This is known as the step response of the system. And this step response can actually tell us an awful lot about what the actual transfer function of the system is. And knowing that, it can help us predict what the temperature at the tip is based on some initial readings. Think of it this way. If I was to put a different temperature at the tip, and I was to let you watch the curve as it slowly rised and then reached its final value, I bet you after the third time or so that I let you do this, you could get pretty good at predicting what the final value was going to be based on just a couple of these initial readings. So for example, if you saw sort of this curve at the beginning, you would go, and say it was going to end up there. And if you saw sort of this curve at the beginning, you would continue this line and sort of estimate where it was going to end up. What you're doing there in your head is actually inverting the transfer function of the system and guessing what the initial reading was based on just a few of the samples and how fast they were rising. Well, what if I told you that we could have a mathematical model of what the transfer function actually is, and we could invert that mathematical model in software instead of having you do it in your head. Well, that's actually what signals people do all the time. And so for a better explanation of this, here's Mike.
Lots of things in nature have what's called a first-order response. In a very general way, this just means that the rate of change of something has to do with how much of that thing there currently is. One example is your body metabolizing a medicine in your bloodstream at a rate proportional to how much is left, giving a biological half-life that's characteristic for each substance. You might have heard this called exponential decay. Another example is a cup of hot coffee dissipating its heat energy to the air and cooling down. Heat is removed at a rate roughly proportional to the temperature difference between the coffee and the air. Finally, for an electrical example, the rate of flow of charge filling a capacitor in an RC circuit driven from a battery is proportional to the difference in voltage between the capacitor and the battery. In this case, you get a graph that looks like this. And for this RC circuit, this graph is the voltage across the capacitor when we suddenly connect the battery. It rises quickly at first because the entire battery voltage is across the resistor. Then, as the capacitor voltage increases, the voltage drop across the resistor has to get smaller, so the current decreases because of Ohm's law. If you go through the math, or remember back to your physics class, the equation for this curve is VB, the battery voltage, times 1 minus e to the minus t over RC. RC is that time constant. So I want to show you something cool. It's kind of special about this equation. If we take V of t and we add in RC times its derivative, dV dt, we can actually use that to predict the eventual value that the curve is going to rise to. So graphically, what this equation means is I can take any point on this curve, draw the tangent line, and if I go forward in time by one time constant, I end up exactly at VB. And the cool thing is I can do that anywhere on this curve. So if I take this tangent line, go forward the same amount of time, I again end up right at VB. So if you want to see this graphically, or in the equations, you can go expand this equation. Get VB minus VB e to the minus t over RC. That's just this part expanded. And then I'm going to add in RC times the derivative of this part, which is 1 over RC times VB e to the minus t over RC. So if you look at this, the RCs cancel, and you end up getting this part and this part completely canceling each other, and you're just left with VB. That's showing the same thing over here. And again, the important thing to remember is that just by looking at any one tangent line, just by knowing the voltage and its slope at any point, you can actually predict the eventual value it's going to settle to. Now, this might sound like a lot of work just to get back to what we started with, but you have to remember, we started with a signal that looked like this. Our measurement capabilities forced us to read a signal that looked like this, but we were able to use math to go back and predict ahead of time what the original signal was without having to wait for our measurement to settle out. And it might seem like this will only work when you're stepping from one value to another, but if you get a little deeper into linear systems theory, you'll see it actually works no matter what shape the input takes. So what we're going to do with the microcontroller is exactly that. Take the sensor reading and its derivative and combine them in a way that lets us predict ahead of time what the final value is going to be.
So now we are going to do the same thing we did before, going from room temperature to hot water. But now we are showing two lines. The blue line is the raw temperature measurement coming from the sensor, and the green line is the output of our predictive filter. Notice how the green line rises much faster than the measured output and is continuously guessing what the temperature at the tip actually is. Pretty cool, huh? There is one last little point that merits discussion. Since we used a derivative to try to predict what the actual temperature was, we run into a problem with noise. Small variations in the measured temperature due to noise can cause wild fluctuations in our guess, so we need to sort of average out these guesses to try to filter away the noise. This sort of sets up one of those very common trade-offs we have to make in engineering. The less we filter, the faster our guess will be, but very inaccurate due to noise. If we try to filter the noise too much, then we pretty much end up with the original slow output signal. So you trade off speed versus accuracy and find the right middle ground, and then get cooking. I don't really want to have my laptop next to the grill, so we are using the Nerdkits LCD to show the raw temperature measurement and the predict value from our filter. You actually have all the electronics parts you need in the USB Nerdkit to do this project. For more information about our kits, or more videos like this one, visit us at www.nerdkits.com. Happy grilling!